everybody, and welcome to the Satisfied God Podcast. This is Raven Bird. Thank you so much for being with me today and taking your time to download and stream this brand new episode. Christmas is upon us. I have opted to put this podcast out before normally I would put one out after the last one, but I wanted to get this one out before Christmas because next year I want to begin back with our concentration on the 8th chapter of Romans. As you who have been listening know, we were in Romans 5 through 8 for a long time. We got into chapter 8, the first few verses, and then we've kind of had a deviation, not as to the context of the study, but as to a concentration on a particular portion of the scripture, which is Romans 8. I want to get back to Romans 8, but I want us to keep in mind the things that we've looked at since our departure from the actual chapter of Romans 8. Because everything we've been looking at beyond Romans 8 or due to something we read and searched out in Romans 8, which is going back to Romans chapters 1, 2, and 3 and our focus on chapter 4 with Abraham and Sarah and these other things that we've been looking at too. All of these things have played a role in, to me, clarifying a lot of the areas, a lot of the things that are pointed out in these four chapters that we've been concentrating on in this study, Romans 5 through 8. So I wanted to get this particular part out because what I want to do today, as you could tell by the title, is put a period on our look at the phrase that is uttered by John the Baptist in John chapter 3, and that phrase is, "He must increase that I might decrease," or "He must increase but I must decrease." And this was more of a departure from the study, so I want to conclude this chapter. Because I felt like I did not get to conclude it, didn't get through the whole chapter, and I need to do that to bring out the full context, at least of that phrase, because there is much more in this chapter, as we'll look at today. We're not going to concentrate on them very much and focus on them and go beyond this time. But I do want to point out some things that are said beyond that phrase that further contextualize and clarify why that phrase is actually stated here and why it must be kept here for contextual continuity and for scriptural continuity. The way we have mishandled this verse, I was talking to someone the other day about this, the way we have mishandled this phrase to isolate it out from this particular area of scripture, take it out of the mouth of the one who says it and understanding why this is the one who says it. And we've isolated it and taken it, applied it to ourselves as Christians and saying, now, here's the process that we're in. The process is, he must increase that I might decrease. And then what that does is open up a Pandora's box of theological conjecture, of self-assessment, of being able to come up with all of these different measurements, levels, so that we can point at particular things and say, yes, that proves that he's increasing and that proves that you're decreasing, good job, or no, he's not increasing enough because your decrease is not apparent. These are the places this has taken us, and it's unfortunate. And for some, it has made them shipwreck. It has caused them to just give it up. because they're honest enough to realize, I can't do this. This is not something I'm capable of doing. But that's not the point of this phrase. The point of this phrase is what we said at the beginning and what we'll continue to say today. The reason it is in the context it's in, and I'm getting right into it, is because John the Baptist is a culminating figure with regard to the law and the prophets. He's not the fulfillment of the law and the prophets, but he is the one person, the final voice, the, let's say it this way, the concluding finger that points directly to the one who is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He concludes the testimony by going face to face with this one and saying, this is him. Here he is. Here's the point. Here's what this was all about. Here's what my ministry was all about, because here's what the law and the prophets all spoke about. This is him. And we said in the previous class where we concentrated on this, and we're not going to go rehash it, but you have to go, if you haven't listened to that, I suggest you go back to that, because we get into these areas and a little more in depth. The idea that he presents himself as the one to whom the bride does not belong, speaking of those to whom he comes, those whom God has intended, those God intended to be joined to this one, this Messiah, this groom. And he says, the bride doesn't belong to me. I am merely the friend of the groom. I am not the groom. I am not the one who will be the husband of the bride. I am here merely by divine right and divine ordination to negotiate the joining of the bride with her groom. I'm here to facilitate them finally joining their hands together and becoming one. Well, they may be found united to the one that God intended for them to be united with. That's all I'm here for. And therein, his joy is full. We went back to Malachi and then speak of Jesus says, this is John the Baptist is the Elijah that you've been waiting for. And the Malachi says that the point of Elijah coming was to join the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to the fathers. And we said we have misapplied that too. We've taken that beyond its meaning and tried to apply it to spiritual fathers in the church today and their spiritual sons, and one being submissive to the other. No, it's not what it's about at all. It is entirely about what the Father said would come. Now their children, this one who is a facilitator of such a thing, John, as upon him the spirit of Elijah rests, of saying, now what the fathers have said comes to be received, realized, bestowed by God, comes to be given by God to the children. So that now the children can receive the thing the fathers told them was coming. And they can realize in the coming of that, in the reception of it, that their fathers told them the truth. And we read that in Acts chapter 13, what Peter says concerning that. What the Father said, God has given and fulfilled to us, their children. John, knowing his role, knowing the reason he existed as a ministry given of God, was not upset by the fact that when his disciples came to him and said, listen, this guy that you testified about, listen to that word, the one you witnessed concerning, he's getting all the people. In fact, the King James says, all men now come unto him. What a statement. And John didn't say, well, I'll be dog, I overstepped my bounds. Now he's taking my ministry away. No, John says, this is what it was all about. I had this place that I was given by God. Heaven itself gave me this moment in time to testify of this one, because I received nothing except from heaven itself. And therefore, if the moment in time has come that my ministry has been realized, fulfilled, that the point of my existing as a testimony of this one has come to its conclusion, because he has come to receive the hand of the bride that I have been wooing in his stead or for him, and my joy is full to hear the voice of the bride call, or the bridegroom call out to his bride. In fact, he must. It is divinely ordained. It is given of God that he is the one that must increase. He must. His significance must be made known. His authority in this situation must be presented. And I must decrease. My authority here is done. My place is realized. My ministry is fulfilled in the coming of the groom to receive the bride unto himself. There's the context of that statement. This is not about men assessing themselves and saying, hey guys, look, do you think Jesus is increasing in me enough? Do you think I've decreased? Am I dead enough? Or is there still something quivering alive in me that I got to kill? And as ludicrous as that may sound stated in that way, that is the gist of many, many Christian conversations. And I'm not isolating just this one verse, but I do believe setting this verse in its proper context may help. And I apologize if I offend some who may hear this and think that I'm just blowing smoke. But I tell you, there is no other way you can actually contextualize this phrase without understanding the one who is saying it and why. You can't take this beyond this moment, because his coming was the end of the testimony. His coming was the conclusion of John's ministry. There's no reason for the friend to be in the picture when the bride is now united to the groom, when the groom has now come. He's facilitated this joining, and now the groom has come to receive the one that belongs solely to him. So, with all of that said, and that again being the thing that we concentrated on and talked about in the last episode, we dealt with this: he must increase, I must decrease. I want to go on in this chapter, and I want us to look at these verses and particular parts of these verses, and I want us to really concentrate on this, because to me it further clarifies the reason behind this statement, he must increase, but I must decrease. And again, you're going to see that it comes to be realized, basically, it comes to be realized in this thought of, I mean, something we looked at the very start of when we began to concentrate on Romans chapter 1, the wrath of God resting upon, the wrath of God is upon men, because of the last chapter he's going to talk about this, and those that believe on the Son are those that do not. Because his coming as the groom, his coming to be joined with those who would come unto him and be found in him and receive him, was not just about them receiving a bunch of stuff. It's about them coming from death unto life. Coming from condemnation to be partakers of a life in which there is no condemnation. Because that's all found. All of it is found in the groom. You can't isolate the one thing from the other, make it two separate things, two separate issues. It's not. It's not at all. So we'll read a couple of verses that we dealt with just to get us started. Verse 29 of John chapter 3. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom, meaning the one to whom the bride belongs is the bridegroom. But the friend of the bridegroom, which standeth and heareth him, rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. This my joy therefore is fulfilled. Wow. Again, this man, not just speaking as John the Baptist as an individual, but speaking in accordance to his God-given ministry, the reason he existed as a ministry on the earth at this moment in time, he is saying, just hearing the voice of the bridegroom, now speaking to his bride who are coming unto him, in this my joy is fulfilled. This is one speaking as the true divinely ordained intention of the law and the prophets. That's what they were given of God to do, to point people to the one that they were intended to receive and be joined to. And when he comes, to say, it is done. The purpose for our existence is realized. The reason we exist as a ministry is done. This testimony has no more authority to exist beyond this one, because now he is come. What a beautiful thing. And it's on the heels of that that he says, so he must increase, but I must decrease. And again, the one is to be to increase in authority and significance, and the other is for the authority and significance to be diminished. Yeah, absolutely. Many commentaries you read today will put this up against Jesus versus ministers of the gospel, just different people, and that's what they're going to say in the latter part of this chapter as well. No, this is about him versus the testimony that God gave called the law and the prophets. That's what it's about. He must increase, but I must decrease. Now, verse 31, we'll start here. He that cometh from above is above all. He's greater than all. He is preeminent above all. But he that is of the earth is earthy. And he speaks of the earth. But he that cometh from heaven is above all. Now, this is a beautiful thing. Again, keeping in mind John's true ministry and what it represents to us as being a culmination of the law and the prophets, their testimony concerning this one, this groom, this man, this Messiah. And basically, John is here describing the distinct nature of both his ministry and the one who is in his coming, bringing his ministry to a conclusion. He is here really, truly differentiating the nature of both the friend of the groom and the groom himself by saying basically this: I am earthly and my testimony is earthly. And this is a weighty statement because of, again, what he stands for. He signifies the testimony. And he's saying the testimony, me, who I am, who I'm a culmination of, as great and divinely inspired as it is yet earthly and cannot go beyond that. Cannot go beyond that realm of things. It utilizes earthly things to testify of spiritual things, but it can never bring you to spirit. It can never provide the spiritual reality it points toward. That's what Paul says throughout his letter, especially in Galatians. That culminating with what he says about it couldn't give life, but it demanded a life that it could not give. John's saying the same thing here. The law could testify by earthly means, earthly words, earthly measures. The baptism is one particular earthly thing that he uses here in this case. These are earthly things that point to heavenly reality that he is. The one who comes from heaven is greater. That's why he says, I'm not even worthy to unlatch his shoes. So he's not just humbly stating how much better Jesus is than him. He is, but he's doing so because he's wanting to point out the significance of the one who's coming was ordained of God and testified of his ministry, speaking as the culmination of the law and the prophets. He's showing the greater reality that is confined to the person of Christ up against the earthly yet divinely ordained and inspired testimony, yet earthly. And it couldn't go beyond that. And it couldn't take a soul beyond that. Its intention was to bring you to the one who could bring you beyond the earthly testimony to the spiritual conclusion. Isn't that what Paul says in Romans 7? I am carnal, sold to sin. The law is spiritual. What's going to bring me beyond this earthly thing, even though applying earthly testimonial elements to an earthly person, there has to be some spiritual conclusion brought about here, and he realized he wasn't the one that was able to do it. Same thing is being said here. The one testifying, John, the law, the prophets, that whole thing, is earthly and cannot go beyond that realm. It is natural and it cannot go beyond that realm. And there's many places, again, the distinction that he makes as far as I baptize with water, but he who comes will baptize with spirit. There's a distinction between the nature of these two. The bride could be joined to the friend of the groom, but guess what? The friend of the groom cannot bring the bride to the intention that God had set aside for the bride to enjoy. The bride had to be united to the intended groom for her to come to the intention for which God created her. Colossians 2:11 speaks of this same distinction between these natures when he said, in whom also you are baptized with the circumcision made without hands in putting off of the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. See, there is a circumcision with hands, done with hands, but there is a circumcision without hands, done without hands, spirit, in the heart. There's the distinction, one earthly, one not earthly. Here's another verse that shows that distinction, the same thing John's saying here. Christ, Hebrews 9:11, Christ being come a high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building. Same thing, not earthly, but spiritual. Hebrews 9:24, Christ is not entered in the holy places made with hands, the earthly testimony, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, the reality, not to appear now, I'm sorry, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Hebrews 12 plainly said that we have not now in Christ come to a mountain that can be touched, meaning it is earthly, it is naturally observable, naturally tangible. We've come to a mountain that cannot be touched, a spiritual mountain, something that is not of the realm in which sight and sound governs, but in a realm in which God governs, a realm he must make known by his Spirit. We've come to that reality. So in this verse, he is further elaborating why the increase of Christ and the decrease of John is necessary here, because all I can do is of an earthly nature. I can't bring you to the heavenly. I can't bring you to that which is spirit. All I can do is speak that which is of the earth and use earthly things to testify of it. But he that cometh after me, who was also preferred before me, he will bring about reality I cannot bring about. Verse 32 goes on and says, and what he hath seen and heard, speaking of the one who comes from above, not John, speaking of the one who comes from above, what he hath seen and what he hath heard. Remember, Jesus says, I do nothing save I see my Father do it, say nothing unless I hear my Father say it. And what he hath seen and heard, that he speaks or testifies, and no man receives his testimony. That's throughout, isn't it? Jesus says to his people in John, to those who he comes to in John 5, I am come in my Father's name, and you receive me not. If another man shall come in his own name, you will receive him. John says he came to his own received him not. John 12 goes on and says, but though he had done many miracles before them, yet they believed not on him. So here he's indicting the unbelief of those that he came to testify to concerning this greater one from above, saying he will come and no one will receive his testimony. But verse 33 does the exact same thing that John does when he says he came to his own and his own received him not. He doesn't stop there. But those who received him, he gave the power to become the sons of God. And here's the same thing being said here. Verse 33, he that receiveth his testimony, that means receives him, he hath set to his seal, that's the King James, hath set to his seal that God is true. The word or the phrase hath set to his seal is actually a word that means to confirm completely, as if it has been sealed with the seal of a king. It is confirmed to the utmost. In the context, it has now the authority and the validity of God himself. If he receives this one who speaks from heaven, this one who speaks not of earthly things, but of the heavenly reality he has seen and he has heard of his Father, then he has set the seal and confirmed that God is true. Those who receive this one, basically, he is saying, they receive the one who guarantees, who is the guarantee, the seal, that everything pertaining to my testimony, what God ordained in the promises and the prophecies he gave, is completely true, and not only true in theory, but true in presence of this one, this groom to whom we now come. He's the seal of God's work. He is the affirmation of God's ultimate intention. And those who received him were now receiving, as it were, the seal that God is true. He has not lied. He has not withheld. He is true. All that the promises of the Father, what the Father said, it is true. The word seal also could mean to stamp with a signet or a private mark for securing it. Receiving this one brings a certainty, a security, just like the signet or the mark of the king that's stamped upon something. It is sure. Well, that's who this one is, the sure word of prophecy, meaning the sure amen of every prophetic utterance that has ever come. And that's basically what this man, John the Baptist, stood as, what the word of the prophets were. He's pointing to this one and saying, here's the sure thing of what I've said. Here he is. Here's the sealing of it. Here's the affirming of it. Now, if you receive him, you'll receive the affirmation, the seal that God is true. And you'll receive in and unto yourself the intention that God ordained for your soul. You'll be joined to the man you were intended to be joined to. And in that man, you'll receive every promise, everything God said, the kingdom and the riches and the wealth, all of it that you are desiring and working for. There's the necessity of this one increasing and him decreasing. We see the confusion and the problems when those to whom he came would not relent and would not let go of the testimonial things, and they wanted to question him. They wanted to hold on to the testimony, hold on to the thing that points to the groom, and never be united with the groom. You see that. That's a struggle that happened throughout his ministry. So verse 34 goes on and he says, for he whom God has sent speaks the words of God. For God gives not the Spirit by measure unto him. You see that? Such a beautiful statement. God does not give this one the Spirit by measure. You remember a long time ago we got into 2 Corinthians chapter 3 where he speaks concerning the administration of death versus the administration of life, or the law versus the one who comes in spirit. And in one place it talks about how the one has a glory, but in light of the exceeding glory of the second, the other has no glory at all. And I forget the exact word. I won't look it up right this moment. You can look it up. But it is not just a glory that they had by their own, its own self. It didn't have a glory that it had innately. Basically, the word study that I looked at said that it was a glory that was lent to it, kind of like the light of the moon is a lent light. It's lent by the true light, the sun. It's the same thing. It was lent a glory by reason of its the necessity that it had to testify of the greater glory. It had to have a glory lent to it so that it could do a proper job of actually testifying of the greater glory. It wasn't the greater glory. It could never be the greater glory. And when that greater glory came, it was seen to be not glorious at all. It didn't have a glory of its own. The only glory it had was a borrowed glory, so it could have actually the ability to testify of something greater. So John is actually saying, listen, this that I represent that and my ministry has a spirit, but it has a spirit in measure. It's just a moment, just a measure of it. Describing the nature of the testimony, that it was lent. It had a degree of the Spirit as so to effectively give testimony to the coming one, the one who is above, the one who is from heaven. But that's it. But the one who was sent, the one who was intended, the one to whom, of whom that first thing gave testimony had no such limitation as far as the measure of spirit, because this one who has come is not just spiritual, he is spirit himself. He's not just something pointing to a spiritual reality. He is the full spirit wherein all reality is found. God has put no limit to the relation of this one to the spirit. There is no limit to this one. He is spirit and he is truth. And he is the fullness of all. And you see this very thing. Here's the beautiful picture that you see being painted by John here, that God has given this one not the spirit with a measure, but the spirit without measure. And you can be taken to so many places, but one of the places you can be taken is 1 Samuel 16 and 13, where it says, "Then Samuel took the horn of oil, the whole horn of oil, and anointed David in the midst of his brethren. And the spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward." And you know what it says after that? The Spirit of the Lord, very next verse, "But the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord troubled him." Now, I'm not trying to put the evil spirit or anything on John the Baptist, but you see the same thing happening here. As what John the Baptist is speaking of in his "one has to increase, the other decrease." The moment that whole horn of oil was poured on the head of the one anointed of God, the one called the king in the heart of God, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon that one, immediately, according to the layout of the scripture, the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul so that it could come upon the head of a greater. The head of the one that was intended. The head of the oil upon the head of God's king, the one of God's choosing, constituted the immediate departure of the Spirit upon the other. There's the increase of one, the decrease of the other. That's just the way this is laid out. It's beautiful. And there's other verses that show the same thing of him having, of this one receiving the Spirit without measure. Isaiah 42:1, "Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him and he will bring justice to the nations." Isaiah 61, of course, we know this one by heart. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me." And according to this commentary, this is the Weist Word Studies, or no, not Weist Word Studies, the Jameson Foster Brown commentary, I believe. "He has anointed me," quoted by Jesus, as to his credentials in preaching, as far as he being not just his credentials in preaching, but declaring himself to be the one who is now the Messiah. This commentary says that he, in this very part in John chapter 3, is saying he has received the Spirit without measure as one that permanently abides on him. It'll never leave. Just like at the baptism when the dove comes just and lights upon him. The Spirit as a dove comes and lights upon this one. Why is this a dove? Why that picture? Well, you remember at the flood of Noah, right? They let this dove out. And if the dove was to find a place to perch, a creation that he could rest upon, well, guess what? Here it is. Here's the place the dove has rested. Here's the new creation after the flood. Here's the one, the newness that has come. The dove lands upon him. God gives the Spirit without measure to this one who is above all, this one who is of heaven, this one who is the spiritual conclusion of all earthly testimony. No wonder he would say, he must increase. I must decrease. Because the two cannot coexist as to authority and significance. So now he goes on and says, and now we go into verse 35. This is such a beautiful thing. Because now you're getting into the nature of this one who has come. The Father loveth the Son and hath given all things into his hand. It's the same thing Jesus says in Matthew 11, right? The Lord, Father, knoweth me and loves me and has given all things unto me. Because only the Father knows the Son, and only the Son knows the Father and those to whom he shall reveal him. And then he implores the Jew to whom he has come to say, come unto me, you who are laboring, are heavy laden and burdened down with the toils of law observation, trying to obtain a relationship with God, a standing before God you will never have, because only I possess it. It's only mine. You must come to me. You can't hold to the testimony and believe you have anything of real spiritual substance, because it is earthly at its best, but it uses earthly, it being earthly still testifies of the spiritual intention God has divinely ordained to come, and I am him. Come to me. Learn of me. Be joined by, yoke yourself to me. This is a beautiful thing. The Father loves the Son. And that word means to be loved, to be dearly thought of, to be well pleased, to be contented with a thing or a person. That can only be said of the Son with regard to the Father. The Father loves the Son. See, when we get into Romans 8, we're going to see a love from which we cannot be separated. And that's not God's love for us that can up and down change depending on our attitudes and our actions and our procedural arrangements, whether we do it good or not. He's speaking about a love that's much more sure, secure, unmovable than that, and that's this one. That's why his increase is necessary and the decrease of the other was necessary, because his coming not only brought about all the promises, it brought into existence and offered to all who would come and receive him, be joined to him as the groom. It offered to those souls who were entirely shut out from such a thing, a relationship, a love from God himself, that could not be conveyed unto any but the Son. And the Son is saying, if you receive me, you will be accepted in me, and you will be loved of my Father, because I am the loved of the Father. And I will be the love of God shed abroad in your hearts. This is one with whom the Father is entirely content. And the etymology of the word, and I put this in the preface of the book that I wrote, Knowing the Satisfied God, the etymology of this word contented is actually where we get the word satisfied. You get satiated or filled. But the etymology of the word contented, it speaks of that which in something content is actually like a word contained, right? Content. The content that is possessed fully satisfies someone. It fully brings in totality the desire of that one who possesses that thing. So in this particular thing is contained, or the content of that thing satisfies fully the one who possesses it. That's what he's saying. Here's where my pleasure and everything that pleases me is fully contained. He's the content of my eternal desire and pleasure. And he is your life if you're born again. And this is what John's saying. Guys, you got to receive him. My testimony can't bring you who he is. It can only testify concerning who he is. You must come and be joined to him. Receive the life of this one. Everything is given to this one. It's given to his hands. And that is given because it belongs to him by inheritance. It is his by right. It is due. It is an obligatory wage that has been given to him because it was intended for him. Now, why must this increase of this greater heavenly above one take place? And the simultaneous decreasing of the one who's merely negotiated the arrangement to join hands between the groom and the bride. Why must he go away and decrease as far as significance in the picture, as far as authority in anything beyond his coming, the groom's coming? Because here's the point of it all. Here's the reason the groom has come. Here's the change the groom can bring about that the friend of the friend of the groom could not bring about. Verse 36, you'll hear my cat eating here beside me. He that believeth on the Son hath the everlasting life. And he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. There's the reason. Because it was about coming from life, or from death to life, from the wrath of God to a relationship with God found in the Son of his love. There's why that increase of the one and the decrease was necessary. This is not some ongoing thing of saying, I don't know, is it done yet? I don't know, is he increased enough? Am I decreased enough? And that's an ongoing, incessant torture ride on a roller coaster from hell that most Christians paid to ride and are still paying to ride it. This is why this increase and decrease was necessary. The coming of the one and the going away of the other. Because even though they abide by the first, even though they believe the testimony, even though they do everything the testimony says, everything, they apply it perfectly. Example, Paul. Example, rich young ruler. Example, all the Jews who were devout toward the accomplishing of the commandments. Yet the wrath of God still remained upon them who held in high regard and gave their lives to the observance of the law and the prophets. Yet the wrath of God still remained upon them because they had not yet believed upon the one unto whom that testimony pointed. They had not yet come unto the one that testimony was intended to draw their hearts as the bride unto. See, this is why Hebrews 7 and verse 18 would say, for there is verily a disannulling of the commandment going before for the weakness and unprofitableness thereof. It was weak and unprofitable because it couldn't bring them to perfection. It couldn't bring them to life. It was weak because of the flesh. Because it made, look, the law, John's testimony, the prophets made nothing perfect. The word perfect we're going to talk about. But what did? The bringing in of a better hope did. By which we draw nigh unto God. There's why the one had to come and the other had to go away, because it was only in the coming of the groom that we actually had any chance at being found in him to draw nigh unto God, to come to a place forbidden, a place unapproachable, a relationship unattainable. John's testimony, John's ministry, the law, the prophets that he stood as a sign of, as a signification of, could not bring them to perfection, meaning it could not bring them to the accomplishment, the consummation. It couldn't accomplish anything and bring them to any completeness. But what did? The bringing in of the better hope. The hope, the expectation that they all pointed to but could not actually bring about. They had to come to the greater. They had to come to him. And that's what this whole thing starts at. His disciples were angry because the one he testified of, all men now come to him. And John says, thank God. Thank God, this is what it's all been about. This is why I exist. See, the law and the prophets was a light, yes, but it was always to draw us to the greater light. It was divine, absolutely, but it was to bring us to God himself through a union with the groom. Not just get us to believe something God said, but to bring us to the truth of the one he spoke concerning. This is such a beautiful picture. Such a beautiful reality. Such a beautiful, I don't know. It thrills me to see this. And I hope it thrills you. I hope you're seeing to some degree what I'm seeing. I hope you can hear in what we've shared in just these verses, just the beautiful weightiness of this declaration, that we don't need to take beyond this context for it to be beautiful and effectual and significant. No, we don't have to apply it to us. It is applied where it was meant to be applied by God, who had it written where it was written, who had it said where it was said. The increase of the spirit, the substance, the culmination, the perfection that God had intended and pointed unto throughout the ages of testimony, concluding with John. Now the Spirit himself comes, and his increase is the decrease of the other. Because you don't need the first when the second is coming. You don't need a finger pointing to when you have the man unto whom it pointed. I hope this has been a blessing. I trust it has. And I wanted to say before I stop, before we cut this off, I hope you guys have a Merry Christmas. Have a great time with your family, friends. Keep us again in your prayers. Kim will have surgery on the 24th. My wife, Kim, will have knee surgery. Fairly simple operation, they say, but just keep her in prayer. And we'll have updates. I'm recording this before that, so don't have any updates on it. So when we come back next year, we'll do that. Let me just say thank you so much for this year. This is not possible without your help and without your support, not only monetarily, which I just so appreciate those of you who do that, but just your encouragement. There's been times this year that I've actually really needed it. And when I needed it, you were there. And I so appreciate it. Hearing from you guys is just such a blessing. I can't put to words how much it means to me that you're out there listening. This year has been a year where the Lord has truly, and I thank him so much for it, clarified so many things in my heart. But that being wonderful as it is, to know that you guys are out there listening and are out there for me to share it with is tremendous. And I'm so happy that you are. So thanks for that. Again, have a Merry Christmas. Have a wonderful New Year. and we'll see you in 2020. Amen.